started. We're here to talk about design and open knowledge movement. But before I get into the details of what exactly is going to be about, we can start with a bit of an introduction about what open knowledge movement is. So I think Sandeep is here to introduce this to us, is going to be talking about it. Sandeep is a community outreach coordinator of India at the Wikimedia Foundation. He's also one of the founding members of the Punjabi Wikipedia user groups, and he was the program leader for the Wiki Conference India in 2016. So over to Sandeep.
Thank you, Saumyaa. So I'm going to give a brief, very brief introduction to the open knowledge movement. Most of us are Wikipedians here, so you know all about it. You know a lot more than what I'm going to say. So it's mostly for newcomers. So Saumyaa introduced me. I need not say it again. So that's it. My email address is sklet.com. I'm going to mention it again at the end of the presentation. So before talking about the open knowledge movement, let's start a bit about the era that was before the copyright arrived. Like, how did we used to share, distribute, create content? It was kind of a community thing. Like, it was not, there were individuals doing it, but still it was a community thing. People were passing it on orally. Sometimes they used to scribe it, but then it still involves community. So the example is Guru Granth Sahib. It has been written by some specific authors, but still, you, because there was no print, you need to write it every time. You need to make a copy, and then there is a possibility for the person writing it, for the scribe to make changes to it. And yeah, that's what that era was about. You could easily share, distribute, copy everything. That was the pre-copyright era, and let's see, like, how did this very concept of copyright and like intellectual property, how did it came to be? Like, according to me, nothing should be intellectual property. That's my personal statement, because I don't think I can create anything just of my own. Like, it has to go through a social process, because if I am a social being, everything created by me should be social. That's my personal statement. So yeah, let's talk about how copyrights came into being with the printing machine. So yeah, printing press started in 16th and 17th century, mainly in Europe. We know a lot more about it, but then with the printing press, there came the question, like, because there were profit involved, there came the question, like, how do we restrict free copying, distribution, sharing of the content? And then came the first copyright law, which happened to be in England in the earlier 18th century. And then, like, by the end of the 19th century, we were talking about internationalization of copyrights. And now we have like copyrights all over the world, and you don't even need to register your copyright. Whenever you create a content, it automatically gets copyrighted by your name. So this is a graph of how the copyrights have evolved, how the terms of the copyright have evolved, especially for this is for US. And how that has been restricting, we can see how that has been restricting free usage of content. We can see that in the very early stages, at the end of the 18th century, the copyright terms were like less than 30 years after the death of the author, the work would go into public domain. But then slowly it has been increasing, and now it's more than 100 years in US. So I see this as a problem, because this restrict free sharing and distribution of knowledge, and this does not allow us to make modifications. And this is, in my opinion, a huge barrier in front of free education. And now I'm going to talk about some open licenses. So, as the copyright movement, like as the copyright thing started in England at in the beginning of the 18th century, it is just a recent phenomenon that the copyright movement also started, in which was like contrary to what the copyright movement said. So copyright was about how do we make sure that the content we create, it can be freely shared, distributed, and that allows modifications. So there have been Richard Stallman created this new general public license in 1985, and then recently there have been more common usage of these open licenses have been through Creative Commons, which started after the internet, after the age of internet, so just 16, 17 years ago. And so there are a bunch of licenses within Creative Commons as well, we won't go into that. But the main idea behind the open licenses is that we can freely share, remix, distribute all the knowledge that we have, like if you allow it to be in Creative Commons. The main idea is that if you release your content into this, you allow it to be used for education and all other purposes. It even allows commercial usage. So some websites which use open licenses, Wikipedia, Commons, Internet Archive, even YouTube allows you to release your videos under Creative Commons license. There are different types of licenses. We can talk about them in detail sometimes. But yeah, that's basically about it. And the very thing that, with which I started was that open licenses are important in a world where we aspire to educate everyone on the earth, and the copyright restricts it, and we should try to release as much content as possible into the open licenses. That's it. Thank you. Any questions, you can ask me on Facebook, email.
Thank you so much, if anybody wants to ask questions, we can also have a quick session after the session. It gets started with the panel discussion. The idea of this discussion is to find out how what can be the nature of the exchange between design and open knowledge movement. What designers need to enable, and what are the values that they need to be looking at while they design. It's a lot to do with the way you, you're looking at copyright, you're looking at the way you create your own work. Also, looking at community knowledge as a separate thing. So, I guess we'll get started with the introduction of the panelists. Starting with Suchitra Balasubrahmanyan, Professor Suchitra here. She's the dean, of course, of the School of Design. I think most students here are from the School of Design. So I don't think she needs a lot of introduction, but her research mainly has been on multiple areas of research in the history of craft and design, and of course design education, design working in design education in India. And her practice focuses on social communication design. Pooja here is a typeface and graphic designer, and whose work focuses on the multi-script design. She has worked on the OGP typeface for Sanskrit language, something we will discuss further during the discussion. And she teaches also typography at several design schools like NIT and Sushti and what's called Academy. Then there is Shyamal, Lakshminarayanan. He's also an independent researcher and an ornithologist. He's been contributing to Wikipedia for over 15 years now. And in addition to his contributions about biodiversity of birds, he's also created separate illustrations of birds on and available on Wikimedia, Wikimedia Commons, and we'll also be discussing further on that. So yeah, we can start it. So I'll start with Suchitra here, and how would you describe the existing ways in which design and open knowledge movement are meeting or not meeting?
Actually, I should also add a few lines to the introduction to say that I'm also interested in this discussion about the work that you are doing, mainly because we are beginning to run a program here on social design, and we are looking at the social applications of design and ways to think socially about design. And in that, I think the idea of open knowledge becomes extremely important. It's also very ironical because we're sitting in a social sciences university in which copyright, protecting your work, publishing, and people not copying and reusing it in irresponsible ways is a big part of culture in social sciences, academia, and everywhere else. So for our university, which believes in socially produced knowledge as well as contributing to it, we are also constrained by an academic environment in which we are not facilitating the exchange of knowledge. So if you are like our library has to spend thousands and lakhs of rupees in subscribing to journals, because no article in history or economics or psychology is freely available. So we are also struggling against this gatekeeping, which is so imbalanced. So people from our countries which have weak currencies, we cannot spend that kind of money. Even if we want to acknowledge and contribute to this knowledge production, we are paying something. The rates at which it is organized is very imbalanced. So, as social designers, we are interested in all of these to try and see how we can intervene in trying to make knowledge free, access free, to have co-design, to design together, to share the creativity, and not that there is one super designer who then gets all the credit for something that he or she does. So community participation in design, co-design, co-sharing of design credits is also something that interests us. But we are a very small community which is beginning that, because design itself is very proprietary. And whether it's structural design, fashion design, copying jealously guarded, people jealously guarded. So it's an early days, right? To answer your question, we should be one of the things in the early days. Mostly it doesn't mean to be
here. Would you say that platforms like Wikipedia enter into the classroom in some ways in the way that students use the existing knowledge available on such platforms?
So as I was telling you earlier in our informal discussion, Wikipedia has a very poor image in the social sciences. And most teachers, my colleagues, get furious if the teacher, if the student comes in a paper with a citation of Wikipedia. And also this is the cut and paste generation, copy paste generation. So they are copying things out of the internet and submitting them as their own assignment. But this makes it extremely difficult where resources like Wikipedia are to make resources like Wikipedia are left it's not valued by panelists. So that the information in Wikipedia is thought to be not valued. So I feel that it's a culture we need to build among students. So how to use this material that's available online, how to use it respectfully. Just because it's open knowledge doesn't mean it was not created by someone and that it doesn't have to be given credit. So open is not equal to stealing. That culture of knowledge also means knowledge sharing, knowledge borrowing, knowledge contribution that we create in school. So once again there is early days. And I think we need to become conscious about how to build the culture.
So, I think to again to Pooja for the similar questions, but having studied and taught design recently also, how do you think the existing interaction is in, do you see students using open knowledge platform, or are there any open knowledge tools that you use for teaching or for practice?
I think apart from Wikipedia itself, there is one of the things that I feel that maybe design students use quite a bit of is a project called the Naidu project, which is basically a website which offers both free and paid ways to basically use icons. Things like that possibly students do use, but the unfortunate thing is that you don't get a sense that they have any interest in contributing to it. When they create something themselves, it's like, you know, it's a rubbish thing, it is to be guarded, but they're quite happy to use, you know, a graphic that is available to you. So that's one, which, like you were saying, is a culture that needs to change. Like, open knowledge doesn't just mean that you can use open knowledge, it also means that it's a community and you have to, in whatever way is possible for you, to engage with it and possibly give back in some ways. The other thing that I think that fail at quite miserably is attribution. Just because something doesn't cost any money doesn't mean that it doesn't deserve attribution or fair attribution, and I think that's something that I definitely feel as a design student I wasn't taught how to do. I don't think ways of attribution was something I learned, and with the students that I teach now, I also don't think that's something that they are necessarily taught or are aware of or think of as important. And that goes to both things they, you know, quote unquote, take from open knowledge or even from things that are not free. They think that, you know, just using whatever they can find online or wherever else is just good. So there is that whole idea of attribution which doesn't seem very well communicated to designers in general. As far as tools go, I have to admit shamefully that despite my attempts to use applications which are open, I have always managed to go back to proprietary ones, because just in terms of, you know, client work, often they are just so much better, which is, again, it comes back to that, right? It's because nobody is contributing to making free tools better. What does help, I feel, as a midway path is working in formats which can work across applications. At least that is what I tell myself at this point, and at least by doing that, whatever work I make available can be used or edited by, you know, people using whichever application, and they're not bound by, you know, expensive proprietary software.
So I think continuing on to Shyamalji or similar counseling lines, do you think outside the design community, when you're designing illustrations, creating them on say popular designing scale, what are the other resources which are open source that you use for design, or design resources that you think are available or use?
I really don't know what design resources are. So, in terms of if you're constructing something visual, you actually have sources that you can use as inspiration. Because you just have to search us on Google. Sometimes it's actually very hard to decide what is attributable and what's not attributable. So for instance, if I was looking at say the shape of a bird, and I looked at 100 images of the bird and I drew an illustration, do I really need to attribute all the people who took pictures of it? So maybe not. So it's difficult to decide how you are inspired. But one thing that I do feel is that if you give back to the community, then the community can actually police it and see whether it is plagiarism or whether it is reusable. So for instance, really simple things. While I was going up one of these South Indian hills, and there was a road sign saying elephants danger. And the image of the elephant was clearly an African elephant. So obviously some road contractor had searched for elephant and downloaded the most media available part. And that's why I did a quick search and I found that there's hardly any public domain Asian elephant which can be used as clip art. So I said this here is something I can do. So I made some Asian elephant clip arts of various kinds, made elephant images, and put them on Wikimedia Commons. So now if somebody goes and searches it, hopefully they will find it. And because it's free, they can go and... I even made it so that, you know, it can be cut out in a stencil. And, you know, you cut a stencil and you can't make an island. So, you know, making this thing. So I thought of that and I created an item where you can, somebody who wants to make an installation or can road sign has a easier source to do. So it's about not just getting stuff, but also in what ways can you productively give back. And on another occasion, I was going up, I saw a hotel with a sign which had a hornbill on it. And I thought this looked familiar, so I went and took a picture of it and compared it with an image that I put on Wikipedia. Now, I'm not a professional designer, but I think plagiarism in this case is a greatest form of clarity. So these are opportunities for, especially I suppose design students can do better than me.
Having established that there needs to be some work, we're still beginning the conversation. If we have to think about how potentially academia in design can inform open knowledge movement and platforms like Wikipedia. So, things like do we need to have theoretical work on this and how can we make the aspect on to open knowledge platforms?
I think you have to start in school. It's not in design schools that you start talking about this. Because already computers, the internet has become integrated into school education. So many, in so many schools, I don't know, our own children have been now starting to use the school projects, etc. So right from there it has to start. The protocols have to be established very, very early on so that it's internalized quite early. I was just thinking as you were speaking that in our homes and neighborhoods, no, when we borrow, say, sugar from the neighbor or something like that, I've spent a lot of time in Gujarat, so I know this is, it's called Bhatki Vyavhar. The relationship which is built around these kategories and things that you follow. But when you return that category, it always has to be filled with something and return, you know. It's bad manners to return something empty. So if you have a cultural practice where when you take something, you give back, if you put sugar, you may give back something else. You may give something you made that day, or just some jewelry or something is always given with something, right? So that kind of a cultural practice is there, that you don't just take without giving back something in return. That needs to be brought into so many other aspects. But it's also an epistemological thing. We think that the knowledge we produce belongs to us, and our livelihoods are connected, especially in design. Our livelihoods are connected, so open source and open knowledge is sort of antithetical to the profession. So you have to imagine the profession itself slightly differently. I don't know how that can happen. Perhaps we need to have a conference or something where people are putting their heads together on this, because it's not that simple. But what we are trying to do in our program, especially in the last the new batches we had, we are trying to make it mandatory that what work you do after interacting with the community, you have to go back and present it to them, give it back, show them what you've taken from their interviews and so on. So in a small way, we are trying to say that it can't become your exclusive property, it has to be taken back. It's not easy to do. You feel self-conscious, you feel scared. It's not easy to do these very community-based projects, but that's the thing that we are trying to do. Whether we should have theoretical courses, I think the ethics of design needs to be discussed much more widely in educational programs. Otherwise, we are teaching skills about how to draw, how to use color, how to do composition, or any type of thing. In a typical design school, we don't do it there in quite the same way. But alongside with that, we need to talk about design practice and ethics. That's also a goal that we have started in the final semester of our program. Talk about the ethics of what we are doing. These are small ways, though it's not very popular in the design firmament. My colleagues in other institutions think that it's mostly people feel that ethics is an issue, as you found out, Sonia, in your own thesis work. A lot of designers believe that ethics is a personal matter. You know, and that it's not a professional matter. So unless this thinking also changes, it would be very hard in the profession to make changes. And therefore, only when the profession changes, can the pedagogy change. But of course, if the pedagogy changes, perhaps the profession can be transformed.
Shyamal, would you, what would be your expectation from the design community if to enable the open source or open knowledge movement? Have you seen any gaps that are there currently in the resources available to you, and in that way can design respond to you?
One thing I think, not just in design but in general in India, we don't understand the fact that every creation that you do is automatically copyrighted is not understood. And the fact that many of these internet platforms are entirely dependent on you explicitly releasing content out of copyright is something that doesn't come easy to lots of people. So I see lots of people who will take fantastic images on and post them on Facebook, on Instagram. And if you ask them, they'll say, oh, you can use the title, I don't care what you do. But they won't put that in writing for any person. They want somebody to come and, you know, only if they know that person, then they won't do it. But once they're released, it's as good as free. But the nice thing would be if they could actually license it. Let's say, whoever, regardless of who comes to me, they don't even have to come to me. Here is this statement which says, go ahead, do what you like with this image. So that makes everything free. So it goes for image, video, and your own creation. So imagine, for instance, you make a rough. And the other thing about places like Wikipedia is that you don't have to strive for perfection. even if you have a rough draft, and if you think you're not going to use it, you can throw it out to the internet. Someone else might use it as parts of something else that they can define. So I mean, at least in the academic community, you know, the idea of standing on the shoulders of giants holds it. And you also give credit to them, and then you say, my own work is also built on that, and I do give it back. So it's a kind of viral license, and that is the model that Linux and other software have used to produce these models. And Wikipedia has also gone the same way. And similarly, a lot of people don't understand that Wikipedia has two parts. One is the written part, which is the Wikipedia. But it also has a larger environment, which includes now things like Wikidata, which is actually a semantic database. And it's got Wikimedia Commons, which allows for media, which is bits of images, sound, and video. And now it's new. Now you can also upload 3D models. So tomorrow you may want to download a model of the Mohenjo-daro dancing girl and print it on your 3D printer. You can do that. But I mean, that's in theory. We don't really have a 3D model of the But it's actually copyright clean. It was done by somebody long gone, which technically ought to be available. So the opportunity exists for everyone, not just in design, but it could be artists, it could be... So for instance, there is one American paleo artist. So a paleo artist is somebody who recreates images of animals that no longer exist. So it's a field where there is no monopoly. Every artist can choose the colors that they love. Nobody is going to question. You can choose the backgrounds. But you can do it with a lot of rational thinking. You can think about in this epoch what kind of plant existed. And so there's a lot of scientific input. And there are paleo artists who are doing their art, and they are contributing it to Wikipedia. And obviously Wikipedia has no source for dinosaur images other than this. So similarly, I'm sure there's lots of material that students can give back. You might think it's garbage, but believe me, every small component that you create can actually find views. If you are willing to say, here it is, go ahead, use it as you like. So that is the first step that you need to do. Second is, how do you actually make it so that the other person finds it? So you need to use metadata that is suitable. How do you write the descriptions? So if you write content that is, if you write, draw a map of your university campus in Hindi with text that says this is a map, nutshell of Ambedkar University, maybe somebody searching for it in Hindi will find it. So it's also about how people find it. So there are lots of things which can be explored.
In terms of more engagement and potential engagement of design and current examples, I think an example would be of the OGP script. So I think if you could just talk about it a bit more, what led to the project and what was the process and the idea and actually impact of that
So the project Saumyaa is talking about is something I did a couple of years ago. It was a small typeface family designed for a script called Olchiki, which is used to write the Santhali language. Even the idea of the project came up because I met someone who used to work at the ATK program at CIS, who likely some of you know, Subhashish Panigrahi. So we basically just met up for lunch to talk about what we were doing, and he mentioned that, you know, one is trying to get the Santhali Wikipedia up and running, which actually did happen in the last few months. But the problem was, at that point, there was not a single Unicode compliant font available in the world. And because there was no font, there could be no text online. Because there could be no text online, there could be a Wikipedia. So that was one of, I mean, that was such a clear example of something where a design intervention could actually lead to knowledge being shared and possibly even created in the future. So it took us a few months to get our act together, but the ATK program was able to fund the project to basically design a small typeface family. What was really interesting here was that because it is not a script that is very common, even though it's spoken by over 6 million people, I mean, in a country as large as ours, that is like less than 0.5% of all the people, so you know, it doesn't count for that much for, you know, the people with power, but also that the script itself was invented, and it was invented less than 100 years ago, which meant that there was very little historical manuscript or documentation that one could look at to even say this is how the letters should look in this font. Which meant that we had no option but to engage with the community and understand how they would like the letters to look and if what we were writing was correct or not. Because obviously, like, I don't speak Santhali, nor did I know how to write, you know, Chikki, though I learned. So, you know, we had to start with things as simple as, you know, just go ahead. So, you know, we tried to look at whatever publications existed right now to see how people were even using fonts in, you know, like written things. So, this is a very popular newspaper, this is a magazine. And then I basically had to start at that point, which is basically like a child. I had to learn how to write, you know, the way one does when they're a child, and you basically draw your guidelines and you practice the same letter day in and day out and you become familiar with it. So what you see in this image actually is two types of letters used in Old Chikki, one for printing, the other for writing. Which, I mean, I personally thought it was interesting because, you know, in Hindi, for instance, you just learn one kind of writing, but this is almost like having a formal writing and an informal style of writing. And then, so basically, Subhashish and I had to create these very thorough feedback forms. So we would do one iteration of the design, and then we would have specific questions. Oh, am I, you know, does this letter look too big? By putting this mark on the right space, should it be a little higher, should it be a little lower? So then we had to find like sentences and words in which those letters were being used and ask specific questions, but also then try and get very general feedback, like list all the letters and ask people, is this letter right? If you think it looks wrong, just, it's possibly wrong because we don't know any better. And then we ask everyone to write the same passage in their handwriting. Because, you know, we only see printed letters and handwriting often gives a much wider view of what letters actually look like. So we did this a few times to basically, you know, learn more about how to make it better, which brings me to what you were saying about perfection. Because designers, we're often trained to only show people something when we think it looks perfect. But this was one of those projects where it just wasn't possible. Like, it was impossible for me to be anywhere close to the space of perfection without having the help of, you know, like many, many different people. So this is what we finally created. So we created an upright weight which was based on the characters which are taught for printing. And we created an italic which kind of looked like the way people do in handwriting, because italics are now required for certain kinds of information in text because English requires them, like names of books, etc. Conventions require that we have an italic, and then we also drew a bold. So as of this moment, it is one of two Unicode compliant typefaces available. There is a Google project about where they're trying to make fonts in all the languages of the world. So they've got something, though from what I hear it's quite poor because there was no interaction with the community to actually design the typeface. And then there is this one, I mean, the Wikipedia was launched, so one hopes that, you know, it will probably see some use. But of the more interesting things that happened as a result, there is a very designer-led thing that happens on Instagram every year, which is called 36 Days of Type. I mean, I think unless you are a designer interested in typography, it's not a part of your universe. But what designers do is every day they draw one letter of the English language. So start with the A and they go to the C. So that is 26, and then they draw the 10 numerals. But this year, as a complete and utter surprise, a student from NIT wrote to me, who herself is from the Santal community, and she said that she was interested in doing a similar thing for Kochi. And she did, which was super great. And she basically got interested in the script itself because she saw that another designer had worked on a project like this. Like, she didn't think this was something viable for a designer to even do. And I think, like, I mean, even if the typeface doesn't get used all the time, I think it's smaller things like that, and it being available for free means that even a student like her can take those files and then try and, you know, make a version of it that suits her purposes a little better.
Again, I think moving into the Indian languages and the scripts, I think most people here in the audience from the Wikipedia community are from different Indian languages community. I think one question I would ask Shyamalji is also, what are the issues that you face while you're using Indian languages in illustrations or even in the Wikipedia pages? And I mean, kind of had the discussion about it, but what do you think is the problem with availability of typefaces which are meant for, say, open source or in compliance?
Actually, the problems with Indian languages there are several problems. Some are Wikipedia specific and some are more general. Of course, the most important one is the fact that because we don't have academic disciplines in Indian languages, we don't have the vocabulary in the first place. So a lot of times Wikipedians are, and we, many Indian languages don't have something like a language committee. So Wikipedia is actually becoming the de facto language committee. And obviously this has its own politics of whether they go the Sanskrit way or whether they don't go the Sanskrit way. Loan words from other languages. So, no one's actually had a real discussion on this topic. And I think one of the good things about English has been the openness in terms of being able to just loan words. I can take in an Indian word and use it in my sentence. So there are lots of purists among Indians who do not want to do this. So for instance, if you wanted to just translate an already existing illustration of say a four-stroke engine that's available on the Wikimedia Commons, and you want to translate it with labels in some Indian language, the job is like almost impossible. The engineer doesn't have the terms in his language, the person in the language feels diffident because he doesn't know enough engineering. And so it's really not going anywhere. So I feel that at least translating English words is the first step. So that somebody who doesn't know English has this one little window to learning what the English word for it is, or at least how it sounds. So and things like the technology itself, Inkscape, using it with Indian languages is, this workshop that we are doing is essentially to ensure that people start using it. There's already this huge mountain of stuff that people have created for English. Here's things that we can do from it without much effort by just translating. So this workshop is essentially to provide all these groups. So in terms of Wikipedia Commons, the way Commons works is that even if you make an SVG illustration, it finally, the engine at the back end converts SVG into PNG so that it can be used by browsers which are non-SVG compatible. So the process of doing the translation involves using open source fonts. So if you use a proprietary font and made an Inkscape illustration, the conversion process will try to use an equivalent open source font, and there are issues with how the layout is, the curling is, how the spacing is. So what looks fine in the SVG version doesn't look fine in the rasterized version. So these are little things. Again, understanding what is open, what is open, what we should use so that this compatibility is better. These are all parts of the learning process. Of course, because we are not using it and because we are not complaining to the Wikipedia maintainers, sometimes even open source fonts are uploaded into the rendering engine and it produces black patches and things like that. So it's a vicious cycle. So we'll have to start somehow.
Ambedkar University Delhi should not
have English, need to have Urdu, Hindi and Persian. Now the thing is that the teachers are not able to teach. You need multilingual teachers. That's another thing. Or you need teachers who can teach in Punjabi design. So we need to build these communities, but I don't think personally, like we had a personal statement, I think we can't be monolingual. It's good to be multilingual. So I'm in favor of English in a way, but perhaps sometimes I also have a conflict that it perhaps doesn't do justice to either Hindi or English. So there's no one neat answer to this question as yet, and perhaps deeper. But I think technology provides some advantages that a student can access if through translation and all. The material in whichever language, I'm a Tamil speaker actually. And if you see a university which is in Delhi, we attract people from all over the country or maybe two of any university. So now we need to be multilingual in different ways. Because a Tamil speaker can come here and say, I have already having my material in Tamil. But if perhaps technology can intervene, provide a layer by which access can be given in the language of one's choice. I could be Japanese and access something about the golden temple or whatever. So, I don't know. It's not just a question of one or two languages, but yes, all languages everywhere. Huh?
This is in terms of inclusion. There's some illustrations on Wikimedia Commons. What do you think has been just trying to enable more and more people to contribute to the visual database, but do you see any shortcomings in that process of creating a larger database of visuals on Wikimedia Commons?
I think it mostly boils down to copyright illiteracy. Because for instance, you know, I don't know how the Wikipedia article on Ambedkar University is. For instance, ideally you should have a map of the campus, a direction map, and it should be there on the article. So I don't know if that exists. So it's something that could have been easily developed out here. But it may not have been put out there because of essentially not knowing its value to the outside. I think by and large we live in this community where we assume that there's no outsider here. It reflects itself in the way we make our road signs. We don't inform anybody where the nearest toilets are. It's all there for you to explore and discover. Or you have to ask. So everything is based on oral gatekeepers. And it goes for, if I'm looking for a photograph, if I ask on a certain channel, do we have a photograph of this church of St. James? So everybody will say, oh, I've seen, I've taken many pictures. But if you look online, you won't find it. Do you have history? I mean, there should probably be an article on the history of this nearby church. So if you go in a, if you look at some of the Eurocentric or American-centric articles on Wikipedia, you'll be surprised to see articles on practically every object in the vicinity of where you stand. But out here, even though those objects exist, nobody has bothered to write about it and to make that writing discovered. So the advantage of using systems like Wikipedia is that you can geotag them, you can semantically describe them so that people from other languages can find the content. So these are things that I think a lot of people don't really understand. And a lot of people don't understand the value of something to an outsider. So for instance, say a ceiling fan that is mounted on a wall. If
if I search the internet for a picture of a wall mounted ceiling fan, how does it look? If I came from a culture that doesn't use it, will I be able to find it? Will I be able to find out similar inventions used in the Persian world, in the Japanese world? Are there such things? So can I find that mapping of how air is pumped in other cultures? Maybe it exists, but these are kinds of things that you are seeking. And sometimes it's so hard to find even commonplace things. And it's just because you assume that it's commonplace. It could be commonplace for you. It may not be commonplace for someone else. So I think these are things to consider.
I think now these are questions which are very like larger questions about design, and I guess there's no answer to them yet. But just to think of maybe potential ways that we can all use, I guess, pitching. Maybe I'll start with Pooja. So as a, you think how designer, design practitioners specifically can be encouraged to engage with open source and open knowledge communities more. And I mean, you mentioned about the industry, about Typeface being out there and how encourage somebody else to start work on something similar. Do you think there are other ways of encouraging or engaging people to do this?
I think one way in which designers can probably be encouraged is in the sort of sphere of, you know, side projects or self-initiating projects, because most designers are not looking to make any money off them to begin with. So the question of this has to sell, and if I give it up for free then I will not make any money, doesn't exist. So that's definitely one way of doing it. And often the things that people are creating as a result of these side projects are resources or tools that other people can use to build something else. So I think that is definitely one thing. The other also is that it is not that you cannot be paid to make open stuff. I think that is definitely a sort of set of blinders that everybody has, that if you are making something that will be available freely, there is no way you can be paid for it. That is not always true. I mean, I designed a typeface, right? And there was a patron willing to pay for it. There are organizations in the world that do even commission projects which are in the end supposed to go out in the world for free, because that corporation needs that thing to be out there for free. Like, it may not even be for some super high social goal, but even the goals of capitalism can align with something being given out for free. And I think it's important to be aware of that, because those opportunities do exist and those opportunities can be sought. I mean, in a way, how different is a patron for an open project from a client for a commission project? I mean, it's someone paying you to make something, right? When we make something for a client, we don't have any, I mean, we have nominal copyright. That person gets to choose how they use it. So we should be open to creating stuff which gets used, you know, openly. Also, like, I think while we're students, there's a lot of possibility that the things we create are trying to solve problems or fill gaps in open knowledge. Like, often, like, I don't know how it is here, but when, for instance, Saumyaa and I were in NIF, we were often expected to work given projects which had a real world brief. Like, we were trying to solve a real problem, or we had to like come up with a real problem to solve. And often some of these problems do exist in the world, and the student projects I've done are probably now on a hard disk that doesn't work. So it's not like I'm making any money off them anyway. Right? So if those projects could then be possibly focused towards contributing to something like Wikipedia Commons, then it is something that you do, which I can imagine that student designers actually enjoy, because their work gets put out there. And you know, like Shyamalji was saying, you could be walking down a street realizing your icon is in the logo, and I think that would be pretty neat for a designer to see if they put things out there. So I think it's definitely possible to sort of get people to at least contribute to the open community in some way, if not entirely.
To add to that, we build a culture among design students to attribute. That would be enough satisfaction for someone who's producing work and contributing it to the open domain, that at least my name or my company's name is not pay me money, but at least you acknowledge that it's mine. That would be enough. And I also wanted to add that some of us design teachers, we are part of this group called Decolonized Design. So basically trying to think about how to find different cultural anchors for design. And we have got together to share design assignments. So what kind of assignments do we set in the classroom to teach various kinds of concepts in design? So we are trying to form an international platform where we can share teaching methods and so on, and make a bank actually of design assignments. So in some, because otherwise these are considered quite proprietary, because you have these star teachers, you know, who have these excellent assignments to teach things, so they become proprietary in another way. So we are trying to do it for ourselves, so that we are able to share the ways we teach amongst each other. So that's one kind of small attempt.
I was actually going to anyway answer about this, but one example of what Pooja mentioned about how students can be encouraged to put out their work after they complete an assignment and go to commons. Do you think there can be more ways of integrating this kind of a practice into the design education? Here at social design as well as maybe a traditional course that
Projects which have a larger use, it's not very specific. Educational institutions ought to put out their work. I think public funded institutions, the National Institute of Design or ourselves, which are not private, we should start. I think the Industrial Design Center in Goa already has kind of portal in which a lot of material is available for anyone who wishes to have it. They have a course in design which anyone can take, register and take. It's just for the certification at the end that they have to pay something and take an exam. Otherwise the material is all out there, the lectures and everything. So that is one way of making your course, because design courses tend to be very expensive. So at least some of it can be made available to everybody. That's another thing. We have been thinking about putting up all our pieces on academia or somewhere to be downloaded for free. So that at least for young designers, it's very important people see their work. If you're so kind of possessive about your work, it harms your own career at the end of it, or at least at the beginning of it. So that's something we have been thinking about. But basically, as I said, it's not in the DNA of the profession, no, to share. So some mutation has to happen.
So again, the thing is, it's both to there's this unique approach of design education, which is learning by doing and not like theoretical text to it, but that process is based on assignments that you do and you learn from them. Do you think this kind of an approach in the kind of part contribute to the creation of open knowledge? I think even, I guess, Chandra can contribute to this.
Hard to answer that question. I mean, I was also thinking, sorry to go back to an earlier discussion, I was thinking about traditional textiles and motifs and things like that, and the indiscriminate ways in which Madhubani painting or Varli painting is put on fabrics, and everything is stolen from everywhere and repurposed and reused in. So it's at the edge of very unethical kind of open source means what? You know, can you just pick something that is from folk art or craft or something and then just start doing things with it? What could be the boundaries of this open source, and does it mean that just because you saw it, it's yours, finders, keepers? It doesn't work like that, right? So the ethical aspects of it really need to be opened up and discussed. Otherwise, it can lead to very asymmetrical knowledge practices. So attribution, the acknowledgement that this elite culturally or individually belongs to somebody has to be recognized. Otherwise, and that is not a legal trait, it's ethical and moral also. So, complex, but urgent, you know. Just because it's complex doesn't mean we postpone it to another day, another generation. So many practices are being established right now, and I think the very technology that enables this, you can also get caught out in it. The very same search engines can show up your plagiarism and build the cultural practice that plagiarism is not cool. To also be put in place.
What your question was, I'm glad to stop. I was answer it
I don't know. I mean, two things come to mind if I understood your question correctly. One was the idea that there is a thrust on learning by doing rather than learning by reading. I think one thing which would definitely be useful is that which is available for reading is open and is available in as many languages as possible. Because I think that can be a huge detriment. And it's not just about, like, even if say it's available in English, I think it's also useful for it to be available in a vocabulary which is more accessible by someone for whom it may not be first language. So that's one thing. The other aspect about doing, and this is something that I didn't really acknowledge as much when I was a student myself, was that even the doing is sort of framed by a certain perspective, and often that perspective is quite closed, and that perspective doesn't take into account where everyone in the classroom is coming from. Like, I remember doing a project, and it was supposed to be an important project, about designing some kind of branding for something for new mothers. Why someone thought an 18-year-old was in any way capable of doing that without any interaction, why it had to be branding in the first place. There are several other design interventions that a graphic designer or a publication designer could have. But I also feel that even the doing is framed in a very closed way, in the sense that it is super like, how do we sell something? In traditional design courses, and there are other ways in which design does intervene in an everyday way. And can those questions then be more open? And also, like, there are assignments where you're supposed to engage with the community, but often you are trying to really not engage with your own. Like, nobody ever gets an assignment where they're supposed to design something for the colony in which they live. They will go design something for like a small town that they will travel 400 kilometers for, where there is a clear asymmetry with, you know, the people that they're designing for, because they have some knowledge, the student has some other knowledge, and then something happens. So even when there is community engagement, it's never with the student's own community. Right? They're forced to sort of either assert themselves in another community or sort of misrepresent themselves. And I think that also maybe takes away from that what is being created as being open, because if they were actually doing it for what was their community, they might be willing to put it out in the open much more easily, because, you know, they can see how it affects people in a much more direct way.
I really don't have much to say about this, but I think learning is a lifelong process, and for me, when I learn something new, one of the things that I do is see if I can find it for myself by
move in. And if I can't find it, I try and put it out there so that one, I can find it myself next time I want it. Two, someone else looking for it has a shorter way of finding it.
Okay, so I think summarizing these thoughts, I think I was going to maybe question this in terms of going forward, what are the possible ways of collaborations? I mean, maybe even concrete ways of collaboration between designers and the open knowledge community. I think some of the things have of course come out from this discussion, things like what the cultural change within design should be from a larger level. And of course things like making things and putting it on commons for maybe design students and encouraging them to do so. In ways in which both designers and non-designers professionally can be take things forward from there. And of course things like academia and ways in which translations can help, what kind of translations, maybe questions around languages, questions around sticking to one language, mixing multiple languages. That was quite important in this discussion. I think I'll maybe start with any questions from the audience.
I would just like to kind of counter one or two points that went around. When we talk of the Wikipedia, we think of 600 students stealing stuff from the Wikipedia and passing it off as her own, his own or her own. But I think we are at a totally different stage here, in the sense that we are actually talking about how students and academia can get involved in contributing to the Wikipedia. And there is this huge page of education in Wikipedia, which tells you how professors can actually get involved by assigning assignments for their students, which instead of ending up on some garbage heap, actually end up in the real world. And I think the crux of the matter today for students in countries like ours is how do we make education relevant in the lives of the common man. And this is what is a different tool and a different way of doing it. Okay. Secondly, I don't think open source, open knowledge means stealing from someone else. That's called piracy. That's another name. That piracy, and no one tolerates that. It means that I am willing to share what I create with the others. So for example, I share 62,000 photos of mine on the Wiki, on Flickr, under Creative Commons. So it's my contribution. And when everyone thinks this way, it creates a totally different way of doing things. If I could just give one small example. So I've been a journalist for much of my life, but last year I decided to take up a job in academia as a humble assistant prof in the Goa University, and I'm from the humanities in the English department. So it's not true to say that the humanities are against this kind of thinking. It's just that we are not aware of it, and we will not be made aware of it because the people controlling all the poets don't want to share this knowledge, and they don't want us to challenge the paradigms which are dominating us, where you all contribute to the journals, but your library cannot afford the same journals. So for example, using this Wikipedia and education idea, I pushed it for assignments and told journalism students that one of your assignments, and the only language they understand, I'm sorry to say, is assignments, is that you have to get me 20 photos dealing with books, dealing with libraries, dealing with writers related to our state, because they are not there, they are invisible. This whole crowd is invisible. And the way they enjoyed it, of course I gave them good marks because, it's not that quid pro quo, but they are doing work which is socially relevant. And I'm happy to say that it was not a course in journalism though, I was teaching that paper, it's a course in English. And out of my 60 students, about 8 to 10 of them have got jobs in different forms of the media today in a course which is not theirs. So the last point I'd like to make, if you just permit me to, there are groups like DNP development, Design and People, which used to be active some years back in Kerala. And these groups are saying that design is not an end in itself. How is it relevant to society? So some of their time, maybe 10%, they give for creating design for NGOs, for non-profit groups, who can't afford it. And like old cheeky script can never come up from the market. The market is never going to give it to you. It has to go beyond seeing everything else for profit. So it's not only what I get back from it, but it's what I contribute to society and how can I think differently from this kind of football game. A few years back, not many years back actually, in 2003, the government of Finland undertook a study on how open source free software in those days was affecting different forms of life. It's affecting every form. So open clip art, everyone knows it's a small thing. You have open law, where you sit and craft your arguments publicly. So instead of, you know, you will lose out on the kind of element of surprise when you present it in code. But you're tapping in on the brains of so many more people that you have a sounder form of argument. You have open source journalism, you have open data or we don't. That's my point.
Any other questions from the audience? If there are questions from the design students about to Satish as well, you can address them. Or you can always catch hold of me. Yes? So I think.
If I draw. Inspired by this Visual School logo, if I draw the logo as a SVG in a SVG file, can I upload to Commons? if they give permission, how can I get the permission by? Is it possible to like, get permission by OTRs from them?
I think on the English Wikipedia you can use it under fair use.
Yes.
But it can't be put on Commons. I don't know whether they would be willing to release
yes.
it.
What's the way to get permission?
It would be interesting. It's possible that one can say that I've designed a logo that would work for a primary school. And let's be honest, most logos are super generic and could apply to hundreds of things. So I designed a logo which I think works for a school and I could make it available freely and whichever school wanted to use it could use it. So,
which logo are you talking about?
Ambedkar. This is
cool. Of Ambedkar.
So that would, Ambedkar would be fair use, right? Because it can't be modified.
So, you can anyway not modify it.
You can't modify it. But it can be available for fair use.
I would, if I wanted to include it on the Wikipedia article, what I would do is stand in front of the gate and take a picture of the.
No, they are very strict. They won't allow that.
So the add-ons can use open art gallery content. You can include that.
This full issue of ownership
Commons will not allow it.
But the full issue of ownership is very controversial. I mean, Creative Commons will not allow it.
That's what I'm saying. Creative Commons, because it's you can't reuse, modify the three R's, it doesn't support. It's a trademark kind of thing. Maybe elements of it you can use. But I don't know what elements
it is. Hi, my name is Revan. I'm actually from the ODRS team. So just to respond to his question, yes, you can upload your work through ODRS as long as the university can grant you the rights to first convert their logo into SVG and for you to upload it on Commons on a free license. So that's definitely possible.
But free license means you grant the right to modify the text.
Yes, yes. If the university can do that, then we
grant the right. But which university will say, you say is it to some other universities?
No, that's just to answer his question whether you can upload. If the university does grant on exceptional grounds, you definitely can take it to ODRS.
What is
ODRS?
Yes, the university needs to send the confirmation email to the ODRS team. That might be a difficult part, but it is possible if the university does release. It's a long shot.
Now,
hello, I'm a graphic designer and a former graphic designer. So I was working as a graphic designer, but I was thinking at the whole idea of copyright. And being used? I mean, this is not really a question. So, like when I was working for a design agency, we like mostly we used to use all the freely available resources, and we used to sell it. And so, I'm sure it's a very nice idea. I mean, it should be all the resources that's being produced if it's freely available, and I think it's a good. But don't you think that either everyone should agree on it or no one should agree on it? Otherwise, like if half of them are like for using it, and like most of them are so like there are typefaces which are like so expensive that no one can buy, and most of the graphic designers, even if it's freelance work or a design, it's paid work, you're always swimming in between all these paid fonts, you know, free fonts. So I'm not sure, and even as a like in a design schools, like when you're taught, even in graphic designs, I mean when I was doing my graphic design, you are taught to be as original as possible. It's yours, you know, like, you know, you, I mean, it's always about that originality that matters. You know, even if it's there, it's a slight similarity between your classmates, you just go back and, you know, keep changing it, you know, try to make it yours, and, you know. So when I was doing my portfolio for my, after my this thing, so I came across this very old project called Hand Painted Type by one of the typographers. So he was looking at all the street, the hand-painted types. So before all the fonts came, they were like signages that was hand-painted. So he went to the artists themselves, and he made the typefaces. And there was one typeface which was free of use, and other typefaces you could download and use, and there will be a part sent to the original designer. So I feel like that is a way of looking at how you can give back to the community as well. So that time I was looking at the truck cart in Kerala, like which I was very, interested in doing. So I started doing research, and I started drawing out all the truck cart. And I wanted to do my own design, but once I started drawing out all of them and vectorizing it, it itself looked beautiful. So, you know, I was in a dilemma whether I should use it because it is a very original design by someone, and I can't just use it for my website, or, you know. So it was always, you know, the education also makes you think that, you know, there should be something original, you know. Even social design, I mean, in our course also, when you're looking at some design interventions or something, like if it was done before, we'll be like, okay, we can't, you know, this is already done before, there should be something original, you know. And I think it starts from the school also, when you are like the whole idea of exam, when you start writing, and you know, copying is one of the, you know, worst thing you can do during exam. I think like when it should start from there, where you can all copy and write the exams. And attribute to the friend, you know, Akash. I copied from Akash, so.
That's called an open textbook exam.
Yeah, open textbook. But from the school, you know, from school you never get an open textbook.
Anybody
I think some of the stuff you said does tie in very well with, you know, what you were saying about journals. Now there is the access to them is also difficult in places where, well, poor places. There's just no way to like afford them. A font which costs like $100 is like, when I was a student, that was my entire month's expense. There's no way I could have like purchased it. But I mean, I think that is another thing that, you know, I was recently at a type conference where someone presented a new pricing model that they were going to try, where they would sell things based on where they were being accessed. And they were being idealistic in thinking that people are not going to mess about with that to cheat them. But they thought that was a fair way of doing things. I think the other thing that you touched upon which was interesting was just this aspect of originality, which really is super important in design school, even though pretty much no one makes anything original ever, because I mean, it doesn't come out of nowhere. Perhaps there is some value in thinking of design more as a I don't want to say group project, because that just brings out bad memories for everyone, but you know, like something which requires more than one person. And Yeah, exactly. For it to be collaborative, and then it also takes away from the idea of what you were saying about, you know, one super designer.
Yes.
Like,
yeah.
The idea that lots of different people contribute.
That is also a Renaissance idea.
Huh.
Have
yeah.
a team of
any more questions from you guys? Anybody else they want to comment? Or?
Yeah.
And then we can bring this to a close. If there I'm sorry for the late lunch, but we're going to get back.
Thank you very much for having this
talk. Thanks to all the panelists, all the audience members, also the Wikipedia community here. And we hope to engage more with you guys on different occasions henceforth. Also with the high students, so thank you. Thank you so much, and I know that you're busy with your thesis projects. Thank you again, thanks a lot.
Thank you for all of you.
Unfortunately,